All righty, and great. So, you guys can see something that says visit us here, right? Okay, great. All right, so as we mentioned, we're gonna go through a little bit of a little overview, and you can see here today we're gonna talk a little bit about the co-op, we're gonna talk about us, we're gonna everybody's membership owner, so we're all familiar with that, so we'll touch lightly on that, and we'll really spend a good amount of time talking about like the board of directors, which is really why we're here today, and take an opportunity to talk through what that's going to look like and the expectations and time commitment and things along those lines. So as we continue to scroll along here, we have our cooperative principles. These are Rochdale principles. All co-ops, regardless if they're a food co-op or not, really follow these co-ops. And so open the voluntary membership, meaning like anybody can join the co-op. There are some certain parameters, as we all know, but really it is open to everybody. The second one being democratic member control. This is a big place where the board comes in, and our board is elected by our memberships, by our membership owners, which basically means like one share or one household is voting for our board of directors. Our third, our member economic participation. As members, we contribute to the equity state, and right now it's $300 to be a member. And we have the equity fund, so it can help us set off any different expenses that we have. Autonomy and independence. We're independently owned. It's not like some big grocery store is going to come in and purchase us or anything along those lines. This is something that's a community store. This is something that we're all bought into. And this is really, an independent grocery store. Education, training, and information. This is something that's really important because we spend a lot of time talking about the co-op, food system education, learning about our own community, finding different ways where we can be involved in the community. And I'm sure if you are active on any of the social media, you've definitely seen different stories where we have our different partnerships that we have, whether it's rounding up as you're checking out and a donation given back to a local nonprofit, or different partners in the communication. So that's community, not communication. So that's really important to us. Six, cooperation among cooperatives. Literally what that's saying is we partner with other co-ops within the region, even nationally. We support each other with resources, person power, finances, whatever it is, we are really a network and a resource to each other, and we lean on each other during that time. And lastly, concern for the community. We find in our end state, our end statements lead us to this. And this is what the co-op is doing in the world. So I'm going to continue scrolling through here. Quickly, these are our values. You can see how these tie back into the principles. And so these are different things that not only the board, but the member, our member owners and our team that's working at the store, we're always keeping these values in mind and always bleeding them together with our different end statements and the way how we get involved into the community. I'm going to just keep us going quickly. So we're a grocery store. We're community owned, and I should know this, but I'm embarrassed to say that I don't actually know the current number of member owners we have. So I'm calling a lifeline here. For any of my colleagues that want to jump in and share whatever the number is or an estimated number.
Hold on, I'm getting it from the finance committee, but I know
I was like, I could
it's
see
okay.
Chad like being like, I'm gonna give you the exact number because
Like
I saw you like clicking around.
going in the minutes.
Yeah. Well, when Chad comes back, he'll tell us that. Yeah, I'm embarrassed that I don't know that. But with that being said, we're open to the public. So, we all had shared earlier that we're all member owners, but you don't need to be a member owner to shop here. This isn't like a Sam's Club or a BJ's. This is open to everybody. And we're really proud of that. And one of the really fun things about supporting local farmers and producers, one of my favorite things on the receipt is it shows you on the bottom how much your dollars went to local businesses. And so that's one way, as you're kind of thinking about how, where your money's going, that's a great resource to look at. And then a hub for the community. You know, we see and learn about local businesses by featuring them on our social media, newsletters. I'm sure as you all have walked through the stores, you've probably seen some really fun signage that's giving special shout outs to that. So that is a little bit about who, like where we are and what we do. And as we continue scrolling down here, won't go into all of this, but we have a really long history here. And what I wanted to just kind of share is, you'll see here in the front here where it says April 2010, they had the first organized meeting. And then a year later, we're able to do the whole incorporate as a cooperative. So it took a year for the community that started all of this stuff to really start the groundwork, to set the foundation, and to really get it off the ground. And so there was definitely different moments throughout the timeline that you can see here where those that were actively involved were helping, whether it was raising money, whether it was researching different real estate. You know, a lot of times most grocery stores is like, okay, well, where's the closest parking lot? Or like, where's the largest footprint? And like, that's where you're going to put it. And that doesn't make sense for the South Philly Food Co-op. We're not concerned about parking. We're concerned more about being close to public transportation. We want to make sure that as the store was being picked out, you know, what is going to be a good location for people to easily get to by public transportation or possibly walk, or maybe there's like ride sharing and things like that. And so this timeline really shows you all of the hard work, sweat and tears, and joy that came out of this. And as we all know, we opened in 2020. For those of you that didn't know, we actually were originally supposed to open like 6 weeks before COVID hit. And then when COVID hit, that really messed up the timeline. And I'm sure we all have our own stories of how that affected our lives and our work and things like that. So we would have originally opened much sooner, but because of all of that, we came to a screeching halt and had to adapt. But when you think about it, I think it really was a blessing because we still had some time to be able to make some adjustments and changes to be able to adapt to like what now an experience looks like shopping at a grocery store during a pandemic. So that was kind of worked slightly in our favor during that time. So I'm going to continue scrolling down here.
Colleen, in case people didn't see, Chad put the member households in the chat, and we are at 1,718 households.
Perfect. Beautiful. I would have guessed 1,600. So I appreciate the exact number. So moving on here, we have our mission, our end statements. Our long-range mission is to tie back to this. This is what we're doing to feed the community. This is what we're doing to take care of our planet. You know, when we're making decisions, when we're talking through things, this is the thing that we keep in mind in the forefront, not only as a board, but again, the team at the store as well. And then our commitment, we provide residents of all income levels access to fresh, local, and sustainable groceries. We are committed to social and economic justice, and we aim to preserve and nurture the cultural heritage of our neighbors. The co-op is open to everyone, not just members, because we believe that all people should have a place at our table. And again, this is another thing that we keep in mind. This kind of keeps our moral compass in the right direction as decisions are being made. It's really important that we are transparent where things come from. We like to focus on local. We like to organize fresh and sustainability when we can. And South Philly is a very diverse neighborhood, as we all know, and it's really important to us that we are keeping those in mind and that we're being good neighbors and that we're keeping in mind the different walks of life. So not only when it comes to the type of products that we have available, but also making sure that we are keeping in mind pricing. And finding ways where we're able to serve as many people as we can in our community. And about member owners. So we're all member owners. And we're not just shoppers, you know, we are involved in this. And many of you have probably heard it one time or another, you know, when we're interacting with each other at the store, it's not like, hey, do you have, I don't know, Granny Smith apples? It's, hey, do we have Granny Smith apples? Or what are the chances that we could get insert some sort of product that might not be there? You know, at the end of the day, this is a community and this is our store and it's us together as a team. So we really like to approach any interaction that we have, really making it a team effort. And it's also, it helps, sorry, I lost my train of thought. I also wanted to mention that that membership owner fee that we have of that $300, that really helps offset some of the different expenses that we have. But we also understand that there are individuals in the community that might not be able to afford that. So we have our community equity fund that helps support people that want to be part of the membership owners and can help offset like financial barriers. And so as we continue scrolling through here, you can see our membership benefits. One of our favorite things is our local business discounts. So you can always check out our website to see who we have different partners with. It's a great thing to go and not only take advantage of some different discounts, but be able to interact with other stores within the communities. And then I'm sure many of you have participated in our owner appreciation days where there's discounts. And there's also different like ways where different vendors have been featured during this time or small events that have happened. You might have seen that our small little courtyard, there was like an arts and crafts kind of opportunity where we were getting that all set up and decorated and people were able to come in and help get that situated. So there's always different ways, whether it's discounts or partnerships, or even just creating like fun events and experiences where people can come and get to meet other member owners and kind of network and just get to meet their neighbors. Those are really important experiences that we want to create. And as you heard me say, we have our one-time investment. So that's a really important thing that I didn't mention earlier, it's a one-time thing. So it's not a membership that needs to be renewed every year, as you probably know. And for those that want to set up like a payment plan that I was referring to earlier, as soon as that first $25 is submitted, like you're a member. It's not anything where it's like, once we get to your final number, that's when you can officially take advantage of all these different resources or perks. That's not how it is. As soon as we get that, you're ready to go. And this is also, as a member owner, this is how people are able to vote. And so we'll get into that in a moment. But as a member owner, each household gets one vote for our board of directors. And so now we are into our board of directors, which is why we really want to be here. But I just want to pause in case there was like anything that my teammates want to add, or there might have been like an initial question that it's like, I'm going to forget if I don't ask it right now. Great. So I'm going to kick this over to Eliza, and she and I will probably tag team this next section as we get into why you're really here today.
Thanks. Thanks for that great intro, Colleen. There's lots of good information about the co-op. So the board of directors has a different role now that the store is open. So I just kind of like bounce back to the history timeline that Colleen shared when we were really an entirely volunteer run co-op. We didn't have any staff. So it was just the board and other volunteers that kind of made the everything go. And now we have full store and a general manager and a lot of staff. And so the board's role is more of sort of oversight and helping think about monitoring how the store is operating and making sure that we're staying fiscally responsible, but it's less of a hands-on, you know, putting together shelving kind of role at this point. So as this slide says, our board of directors is responsible for governing the co-op, and they're elected member owners. elected by the member owners and act on the member owners' behalf, thus the democratic control of the store. And the goal is to make the decisions in the best interest of the collective organization and the community. So our board elections take place every year at the annual spring general membership meeting. We have two general membership meetings a year, one in the fall and one in the spring. It's usually in the sort of like late May, early June time. And each director, after being elected in that election, serves a two-year term. And the term starts in July following that election. And the board is composed of anywhere from 9 to 11 members, and it's all volunteer, we're not compensated. Eligible candidates must be at least 18 years old, and they have to be in good standing on their member owner equity investment. So correct me if I'm wrong, Chad, but the one thing that Colleen said about sort of it being a one-time payment, and as soon as you've made that first $25 payment, you're a member, that is true. But in order to run for the board, you have to be fully paid up. Am I right about that?
We've had board members who are in their payment plan, and that's okay. If you're Lori had determined that if someone's making payments on their equity, that she'll consider them a member in good standing. And so we haven't gotten into that really.
Okay. So it's only if you're like delinquent in your payments that.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Or if they've lapsed for some reason.
Okay. Thank you for clarifying. All right. You want to scroll down, Colleen? So this is a summary of the board's responsibilities. This is very tiny, and I don't know if other folks can read it. I have bad eyes. I need new glasses. But the job of the board is to represent the members in defining and monitoring appropriate organizational performance and envisioning the long-range direction of the organization. So in order to do this successfully, there's a whole bunch of sort of job tasks that are outlined here, but things like practice, protect, promote, and perpetuate a healthy democracy for the co-op, seek out members and potential members and listen to their ideas and things that they'd like to see implemented at the store so that we can be sure that we're acting on behalf of the member owners. Our role is, we are sort of the boss for the general manager. So hire, set compensation for, delegate responsibility to, and hold accountable the general manager. And let's see if there's any other things that I want to pull out here. We do a lot of the sort of like long range planning and thinking about the organizational goals. So Colleen mentioned a few times our end statements, and those are sort of like our actionable goals that we set in order to carry out our mission statement. And so that's a process that it's sort of iterative. We've set end statements, but every couple of years we reevaluate, and there's a lot of the board meetings involve thinking through our various policies and making sure that we're in compliance with those and seeing if there are ways that we need to tweak our policy register so that we're more in line with the way the store is operating and things like that. Anything else on here, Colleen, that I should pull out specifically? Does anyone have any questions?
I more just was going to say, no, this looks really overwhelming. Don't let it look overwhelming. At the end of the day, like, as Eliza said, this is a volunteer opportunity. This is, I don't want anybody feeling like, oh my God, like I'm applying for a job. I got to get like my resume like buttoned up, like all that. That is not the case at all. We just want to like give as much information upfront as possible, so everybody just has an idea of what to expect. And as Eliza mentioned, like we meet once a month as an entire board. And currently we meet the last Monday of every month. And our meetings are typically 6:30 to 9 o'clock. Some are the entire length. Sometimes in meetings, we are able to be pretty efficient and can wrap up before that. But not only are we meeting once a month as an entire board, but we also are on different committees. So there's the governance committee that you probably heard a bunch of times, the finance committee, as well as the membership committee. So we're all on the board as a team. And then we all kind of branch off into a different committee that also meets once a month. You might be sitting there being like, all right, how many hours a month are we looking at? give or take, depending on the month and like depending on like what each committee is working on, I would say it could be about like 10 hours a month. Some months might be a little bit less, some might be like a little bit more. So like the governance committee right now, like we're focusing on the election. So like we're a little bit busier with getting that going. The membership committee, they're focused on our spring membership meeting. And so these next couple months are gonna be spending some time on that. Finance committee is exactly what it sounds like. And finances are always happening. So they always have like a constant little buzz of work happening. But Eliza, I will kick, Chad.
Sorry, can I piggyback? I just wanted to share that the finance committee is interesting though, because their work tends to happen only within their meetings. So of all of our committees, that's like the least, like the smallest time obligation. It tends to like a member on the finance committee probably is giving like 5 hours a month or so, I'd say, just like for reference. Although the finance committee seems like the scariest because there's like a lot of numbers, but in some ways it's the easiest as far as time. So for whatever that's worth, if you're gonna join the board, come to the finance committee, it's fun.
Chad's always trying to recruit people to the finance committee. I will also add that in addition to each board member serving on a committee, once board members are in their second term, they're eligible to run for the 4 seats of the executive committee. So that's the director of the board, the vice president, I should know this, treasurer and secretary. And so obviously if you serve in one of those roles, there's a little bit of extra added time commitment, but that's not something you need to worry about in your first year because you have to have been on the board for 1 year before you can do that. Okay, so this was our little sort of statement about what we're looking for in terms of core competencies in new board members who would be joining the board. This spring, we're going to be electing between 3 and 5 directors for the board. And we have 2 board members currently who are running for re-election, so for a second term. And then several board members who are going to be rolling off the board as well. And the directors who are leaving this year have been really excellent in offering leadership in the areas of finance, marketing, outreach, personnel management, community engagement, event planning, and project management. So we're always looking to kind of make sure that we have a broad array of skill sets represented on our board. And specifically, these are the skill sets that we sort of set out saying that we definitely are hoping to find in potential board candidates this year. So appreciation for and experience with good governance and group process, ability to think strategically, and that means holding the big picture and the little details in the same frame, organizational and financial development, training, curriculum, and professional development. So anyone who has experience with HR is always a plus. Any experience with community engagement, event planning, or project management. Public speaking is a part of the role if you want it to be, but it's not required. And there are often opportunities to go to community events or to speak to the general membership, but for folks who don't like public speaking, it's definitely not a requirement. Negotiation and diplomacy, eagerness to learn, and a really strong commitment and attention to community. Particularly the South Philly community. Anything, any questions there? Anything anyone else wants to add? All right, so as we mentioned already, anyone over the age of 18 is eligible to, and who is a member in good standing is eligible to run for the board. And in order to do that, you need to submit a declaration of candidacy, which is what you see here on the right. You submit a little bit of information about yourself and answer a few questions. The deadline for submitting the declaration of candidacy is March 31st at 8 p.m. And Board of Elections will take place on June 1st at our general membership meeting. Between declaration of candidacy and the GMM, we will have a couple of, or one, just one meet the candidates session. And we, if you decide to run, what we're gonna do is send around a poll of a few potential dates, and we'll pick the one that works with the most number of candidate schedules. And for anyone who can't be there, you're welcome to either submit written answers to a few questions or a little video of yourself answering those questions so that you can still be represented at the event. Any questions there? I'm looking to see, Colleen, do we have in the dates to know? No. Yeah, it just says May TBD meet the candidates. So yes, it will send around potential dates once once everyone has declared their candidacy. So after a meet the candidates event, board elections will be finalized, like I said, at the spring GMM. And member owners can either cast their ballots in the store online, or and that happens through like a ballot that is emailed to you, or via mail leading up to the meeting. We used to do voting at the meeting, but our meetings are all virtual now in the COVID era, so we don't do that anymore. Like I said, in order to remain in compliance with our bylaws, we need to elect between 3 and 5 directors this year. And then in terms of onboarding, once you join the board, if elected, new directors are paired with a board buddy. So that's someone who's been on the board previously, and they start their term in July, and the board buddy is there just to kind of help. We do a full sort of 1-day orientation onboarding for all new members, but there are always more questions that come up. Maybe you're sitting in a meeting and you're like, I really don't understand this financial thing we're discussing. That's what the board buddy is there for. You can reach out to them at any time to meet one-on-one and find out more information, get answers to your questions. I had another thought of something I was gonna say and I just forgot what it was. But if anyone has any questions, jump in. Maybe it'll come back to me. Anyone else wanna add something?
No, that was really it. I saw that, I'm gonna stop sharing my screen. I saw that Chad had put in the chat some important dates. And Molly, thanks for asking that question about all the things. We'll definitely share the important dates and any of the documents that were shared here today. and we'll guide you all through this process. I do wanna say that the application process might seem a little overwhelming. And I don't want anybody to feel that way. I definitely understand that when it comes to typing up responses for some individuals, that can be really stressful. And we don't want to create that type of environment. So if somebody is kind of like, I really don't know how to respond to these questions, or just not confident in typing out like a paragraph, it can be bullet points. It can be very casual. It can really be whatever works best for that individual. And we're a resource. So if there's something that anybody is wants to report on or wants to talk through, you know, you shoot us an email and we'll guide everybody through that process. Again, this is a volunteer opportunity. We do not want to make it an unpleasant experience. But we also know that, you know, like running for something for an election can have a lot of different excitement and different feelings that come along with that. And so we just want to be able to help manage that as individuals are going through that. So we are a resource. We are here to guide everybody through that. And no question is a silly question, because typically one individual has a question, it's very similar to other questions that have come from other people that are interested in running for the board. I do want to invite you to come and observe any of our board meetings. They're always open, but we do have February's board meeting is this coming Monday, because we're rolling into last Monday of the month. So February 28th at 6:30, and then we'll do it again March 28th. So if either of those dates work for you, you just let us know. We'll send you the Zoom link. And it's a great opportunity for you to, one, see our current board members. It's also a great opportunity to get an idea of the type of conversations that we have and what a typical board meeting looks like. So hopefully it will work with your schedule and you can join us. And I also wanted to remind everybody that to piggyback off of what Eliza had said for the election, we will be working with our colleague Natalie, who will get Helios set up. So you might hear that term a lot. That is our digital election equipment
platform.
But thank you. I'm struggling there. So wanted to mention that as well. But I did a lot of talking and I would love to just not talk and answer any questions or allow for comments to be made.
I don't have any questions right now, but I am interested in potentially joining the board call next Monday, just to get a sense of like what it's like before I go through the application process. That sounds great.
Molly, great. I'll send you a calendar invite with the Zoom information right now, okay?
Okay, that'd be great.
I have a question, like where can we find the application?
Absolutely. So it should be on our website, but I'm also gonna drop a link in the chat so you have it. I just need a moment so I can open that up. And it will also be included in our different newsletters that will be going out over the next several weeks as well. Great question.
I didn't say this explicitly when I was talking, but it's as Colleen has mentioned, we want this to be like an enjoyable experience. And I will say from my personal experience that being on the board has been really fun and has been really rewarding. It's been a great way to meet a lot of my neighbors and get involved in the community. And I'll be honest and say it was more fun pre-COVID when we would have our meetings in person and eat lots of yummy snacks. But it's still fun even over the computer.
And I'll share that, you know, something that our group has been really passionate about is always trying to leave the board in a better condition than we found it. So that's not to say that any prior board was doing like bad work. It's just that we're really committed in a way that I haven't experienced in other nonprofits to this like continual self-improvement. And our board spends a lot of time and energy trying to always evaluate what we've done in the past to be sure that we do it better next time. So with that in mind, you know, we're always trying to like learn from our lessons. And I think it's just like such a great way, if you haven't had board service in the past, it's a great way to start and learn how to serve on a nonprofit board. Consumer co-ops are really unique businesses, but it's just like a great like safe place to like enter into that where there isn't like a lot of judgment, and you know, there's so many people who feel like they don't have the skills to be a director and then come and really shine. She's not here today, but I'm gonna speak for her. Like our current treasurer was really, really nervous to be our treasurer. She didn't feel that she had the financial acumen to do that, and she's the best treasurer we've had in our history. So it's really easy to be successful and to make an impact. And so if you're feeling like it's outside of your comfort zone, I challenge you to run anyway and find out exactly how good you'll be at it. I never imagined that I would ever be the president of this co-op, and somehow I am. And somehow it's functioning. And I wish I credit to all of the really great board recruitment we've done, because I have no idea what I'm doing 95% of the time, but look at us go. So I look forward to seeing you both on our board now and in the future. so that Eliza and I don't have to be board officers anymore. We can pass this baton on to the next group of folks.
I'm just gonna, this has already been dropped in the chat a couple times, but I'm just gonna put our email there because I'm sure there might be some follow-up questions or anything like that. So, and it's also listed in the newsletters that you've all have probably seen. So don't feel like if you lose it today, there will be other times that you will see it and can shoot us a note. But we have a couple minutes left, opportunity to answer any more questions, or we can wrap up and enjoy our beautiful Saturday.
No, I just thank you guys for taking the time. I really appreciate it.
Absolutely. Thanks, Molly.
Yeah, thank you both for attending. And like Colleen said, feel free to reach out if any questions come up. And hopefully we'll see you at a board meeting sometime in the next month or two.